Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus proceeded on his journey up to Jerusalem. As he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. He said, "Go into the village opposite you, and as you enter, you will find a colt tethered, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone should ask you, 'Why are you untying it?' you will answer, 'The master has need of it.' So those who had been sent went off and found everything just as he told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying this coat?' They answered, 'The master has need of it.' So they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks over the colt, and helped Jesus to mount. As he rode along, the people were spreading their cloaks on the ground. And now, as he was approaching the slope of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to praise God with joy for all the mighty deeds they had seen. They proclaimed, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' He said in reply, 'I tell you, if they kept silent, the stones will cry out.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaim Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace.
us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and I have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help. Therefore, I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My God, why have you abandoned me? My God, why have you abandoned me?
All who see me deride me.
Their heads. He trusted in the Lord, let him say. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, and at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend, and those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, O Lord.
You may be seated.
When the hour came, Jesus took his place at table with the apostles and said to them,
I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it again until there is fulfillment in the kingdom of God.
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and said,
take this and share it among yourselves. For I tell you that from this time on, I shall not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.
Then he took the bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them, saying,
this is my body, which will be given for you. Do this in memory of me.
And likewise the cup after they had eaten, saying,
this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which will be shed for you. And yet behold, the hand of the one who is to betray me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed.
And they began to debate among themselves who among them would do such a deed. Then an argument broke out among them about which of them should be regarded as the greatest. He said to them,
the kings of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those in authority over them are addressed as benefactors. But among you it shall not be so. Rather, let the greatest among you be as the youngest, and the leader as the servant. For who is greater? The one seated at table or the one who serves? Is it not the one seated at table? I am among you as the one who serves. It is you who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer a kingdom on you, just as my Father has conferred one on me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and you will sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has demanded to sift all of you like wheat. But I have prayed that your own faith may not fail. And once you have turned back, you must strengthen your brothers.
He said to him,
Lord, I am prepared to go to prison and to die with you.
But he replied,
I tell you, Peter, before the cock crows this day, you will deny three times that you know me.
He said to them,
when I sent you forth without a money bag or sack or sandals, were you in need of anything?
No, nothing.
They replied, he said to them,
but now one who has a money bag should take it, and likewise a sack. And one who does not have a sword should sell his cloak and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me, namely, he was counted among the wicked. And indeed, what is written about me is coming to fulfillment.
Then they said,
Lord, look, there are two swords here.
But he replied,
it is enough.
Then going out, he went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. When he arrived at the place, he said to them,
pray that you may not undergo the test.
After withdrawing about a stone's throw from them and kneeling, he prayed, saying,
Father, if you are willing, take this cup away from me. Still, not my will, but yours be done.
And to strengthen him, an angel from heaven appeared to him. He was in such agony, and he prayed so fervently that his sweat became like drops of blood falling on the ground. When he rose from prayer and returned to his disciples, he found them sleeping from grief. He said to them,
why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not undergo the test.
While he was still speaking, a crowd approached, and in front was one of the 12, a man named Judas. He went up to Jesus to kiss him. Jesus said to him,
Judas, are you betraying the Son of Man with a kiss?
His disciples realized what was about to happen, and they asked,
Lord, shall we strike with a sword?
And one of them struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. But Jesus said in reply,
stop, no more of this.
Then he touched the servant's ear and healed them. And Jesus said to the chief priests and temple guards and elders who came for him,
have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs? Day after day I was with you in the temple area, and you did not seize me. But this is your hour, the time for the power of darkness.
After arresting him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat around it, and Peter sat down with them. When a maid saw him seated in the light, she looked at him intently and said,
this man too was with him.
But he denied it, saying,
woman, I do not know him.
A short while later, someone else saw him and said,
you too are one of them.
But Peter answered,
my friend, I am not.
After an hour later, still another insisted,
assuredly, this man too was with him, for he is also a Galilean.
But Peter said,
my friend, I do not know what you are talking about.
Just as he was saying this, the cock crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him,
before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times.
He went out and began to weep bitterly. The men who held Jesus in custody were ridiculing and beating him. They blindfolded him, questioning him, saying,
prophecy, who is it that struck you?
And they reviled him and saying many other things against him. When day came, the council of elders of the people met, both chief priests and scribes, and they brought him before the Sanhedrin. They said,
if you are the Christ, tell us.
But he replied to them,
if I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question, you will not respond. But from this time on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the power of God.
They all asked,
are you then the Son of God?
He replied to them,
you say that I am.
Then they said,
what further need have we for testimony? We have heard it from his own mouth.
Then the whole assembly of them arose and brought him before Pilate. They brought charges against him, saying,
"We found this man misleading our people. He opposes the payment of taxes to Caesar and maintains that he is the Christ, a king."
Pilate asked him,
"Are you king of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds,
"I find this man not guilty."
But they were adamant and said,
"He is inciting the people with his teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began, even to here."
On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. And upon learning that he was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was in Jerusalem at the time. Herod was very glad to see Jesus. He had been wanting to see him for a long time, for he had heard about him and had hoped and had been hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but he gave him no answer. The chief priests and scribes, meanwhile, stood about accusing him harshly. Herod and his soldiers treated him contemptuously and mocked him. And after clothing him in resplendent garb, they sent him back to Pilate. Herod and Pilate became friends that very day, even though they had been enemies formerly. Pilate then summoned the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought this man to me and accused him of inciting the people to revolt. I have conducted my investigation in your presence and have not found this man guilty of the charges you have brought against him. Nor did Herod, for he sent him back to us. So no capital crime has been committed by him. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
But all together they shouted out,
"Away with this man! Release Barabbas to us."
Now Barabbas had been in prison for a rebellion that had taken place in the city and for murder. Again, Pilate addressed them, still wishing to release Jesus, but they continued their shouting,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate addressed them a third time,
"What evil has this man done? I found him guilty of no capital crime. Therefore, I shall have him flogged and then release him."
With loud shouts, however, they persisted in calling for his crucifixion, and their voices prevailed. The verdict of Pilate was that their demand should be granted. So he released the man who had been in prison for rebellion and murder, for whom they asked, and he handed Jesus over them to deal with as they wished. As they led him away, they took hold of a certain Simon of a Cyrene, who was coming in from the country. And after laying the cross on him, they made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of people followed Jesus, including many women who mourned and lamented him. Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. Weep instead for yourselves and for your children. For indeed the days are coming when people will say, 'Blessed are the barren, the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' At that time people will say to the mountains, 'Fall upon us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if these things are done when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry?"
Now two others, both criminals, were led away with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull,
"Fear of God, for you are subject to the same condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we receive corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal."
Then he said,
"Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
He replied to him,
"Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
And when he had said this, he breathed his last. The centurion who witnessed what had happened glorified God and said,
"This man was innocent beyond doubt."
When all the people who had gathered for the spectacle saw what had happened, they returned home beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances stood at a distance, including the women who had followed him from Galilee and saw these events. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph, who, though he was a member of the council, had not consented to their plan of action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea, and he was awaiting the kingdom of God. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb in which no one had yet been buried. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come from Galilee with him followed behind, and when they had seen the tomb and the way in which his body was laid in it, they returned and prepared spices and perfumes. Then they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
First of all, a huge big apology to everyone. This is the first time in 24 years that we have ran out of palms on Palm Sunday. So I very much apologize for that. We ordered 2,500 and we have only had about 900 people at the last two masses. So obviously some people took more. So at any rate, I do apologize, but it's one of those things. Next year we'll learn to order twice as many more. But if, for example, you have a family and not everybody wants one, you might leave it so that the people at the other mass can do that. And I plan on ripping apart a couple of palm trees during the break to try to get some more. Well, don't worry. On Palm Sunday, I don't give a really long homily because I think the passion really, it speaks for itself. And there's not really much you can add to that. But it is the beginning of Holy Week. And the Passion is this beautiful story of Jesus' betrayal and what happened to him. And this is the most sacred week in the year of the church. As we walk with Jesus from his entry into Jerusalem, which we commemorated today, to his Last Supper, to his death, and finally the resurrection at Easter. This is the week that changed salvation history forever. Now, I know that it's a busy week for many people, lots of stuff going on, but I encourage you to really take the time out of your schedule to walk with Jesus and participate in the Holy Week services because they're beautiful and meaningful. Holy Thursday is the celebration of the Lord's Supper, where Jesus had his last meal with his disciples, instituted the Holy Eucharist and the priesthood, and also then washed the feet of the disciples, giving them the mandate to go out and serve. As he says, "As I have done, so you must do." So it's more than just the washing of feet. Then at the end, the altar is stripped and our Lord is moved to a special altar of repose for adoration until midnight. Then on Good Friday, the church is completely bare. We again hear the Passion, a little bit different version, but essentially the same story. And the church, like I said, is bare, but we receive Holy Communion, which was consecrated on Holy Thursday. And then we come forward and venerate the cross, which took Jesus' life, but gave us eternal life. Then at the Easter Vigil, we bless the new fire, the new Easter candle. We hear the story of creation in the chanted prayer, the Exultet, and in the readings. We bless new baptismal water, we renew our promises of baptism, and then we baptize and confirm new members to our church. So think of the sacred triduum, that's Latin for 3 days, as all one liturgy, which it really is, or like a play or a drama. To get the fullness of Easter, we really have to come on Thursday and Friday, as well as Easter Sunday. Because if we only come at Easter, not that that's bad, but it's like going to a play or maybe a basketball game and only going for the last act or the last quarter. For years, people have been telling me, oh, you should watch Downton Abbey. You would really love it. Being British and all that, you would just love that. And I said, I don't got time for that. I'm not doing it. And so I didn't watch it until the very last maybe 4 or 5 episodes, and it was really good. And so I missed a lot of the story by not watching the whole thing. Now, I am not in any way comparing the Passion of Our Lord to Downton Abbey, so do not go out of here and say that. I'm using that as an example of how if you come in at the end, you miss a lot of what goes on before. And you can go out and get a box set of DVDs for Downton Abbey, but you can't get that for Holy Week. And yes, I am aware that there is a Thunder game on Holy Thursday. And several people ask, now, was that known when that date was set? And I said, well, with all due respect to the NBA, I can safely say that Holy Thursday came first by about 2,000 years. I guess back in those days, they probably had the NGA, the National Gladiators Association, or something like that. So I hope to see all of you on Thursday and Friday as well as Easter, because I can safely say that if you do that, you will have the most beautiful Easter you've ever had. Now, on Easter, if you want to avoid the crowds, come to the Vigil. That is certainly the most beautiful liturgy of the year. It's a little longer, but it's very beautiful. And on Sunday next week, there will be overflow seating with closed-circuit television in the atrium at both the 8 and the 10 o'clock masses. There will also be, since there are not confessions on Holy Saturday, I will be hearing confessions tonight from 5 to 6, tomorrow night from 5:30 to 6:30, and Wednesday from 5:30 to 6:30. And so may God bless us all as we walk with the Lord to celebrate this beautiful week of His Passion, His death, and His resurrection, which gave eternal life to us all.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And now let us bring our prayers to the Lord.
For the church, that we may speak a word of hope and mercy to all who are burdened, searching, or yearning for a better life, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for all who are suffering, particularly Christians in the Middle East and China, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have been humiliated and denigrated, that they may find their value and worth in being children of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have been condemned to death, that the Holy Spirit will help them turn to God and find hope and peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are incarcerated, and for those who serve them in ministry, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In thanksgiving for the Christ the King youth mission trip, may the fruits of their mission continue to ripen in the lives of the missionaries and those they encountered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the souls of all the faithful departed, especially David Cooper, Joseph Wozinski, Butch Chancellor, Jimmy Pacheca, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In silent prayer, let us now mention our own special intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we ask you to hear these prayers and those that we hold in our hearts. Continue to show us your mercy and your love, and we ask all of this through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by the sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and
it is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, plenis uccelli et terra.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Paul, our Bishop, and all those who, holding on to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmos and Damien, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. And once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
Save us, Savior of the world, for by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, who through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Remember especially Hong Lee. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive
trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us share with one another the sign of peace.
Agnus Dei,
qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Oh,
for those of you who did not get a palm, the only thing I can do is order. We will order some more. I'll bless them and then have them available on Holy Thursday and Good Friday, unless you want to wait around for me to chop up the potted palm. Please join us in the atrium today to welcome our new members down at the welcoming desk. If you had your picture taken for the parish directory, we still have many that have not been picked up. They're down there on the tables in the foyer. Also, all of you who had your picture made, you get a free 8x10 portrait. And if you did not have your picture taken but you'd like to purchase a directory, there are $10 in the parish office. Adoration tomorrow will not begin until noon due to the funeral of David Cooper. As I mentioned, this is Holy Week. There's a lot going on. Please take a bulletin. There will not be confessions next Saturday, so I will hear confessions this evening from 5 to 6, tomorrow from 5:30 to 6:30, and Wednesday from 5:30 to 6:30. There is an error in the bulletin. There will not be a 5:30 p.m. Mass on Tuesday due to the Chrism Mass down at the Cathedral. The Holy Thursday Mass is at 7 p.m., adoration until midnight. Good Friday services are at 3 and 7. The Easter Vigil, in which we baptize and welcome new members into the church, that will be at 8 p.m. next Saturday. There will not be a 5 p.m. Mass next Saturday. And the Sunday morning Masses are the regular times. There will be an Easter egg hunt after the 10 o'clock Mass for the children. Also, if you have not yet made your pledge to the Archdiocese appeal, please do so. We're still behind by several thousand dollars, and we really need to make our goal. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.